Okay, hey guys, so welcome back to the lecture. So we are already in lecture 3 this week, and we'll be talking about network addressing. This is a very important lecture for this subject, and we'll be doing this in two parts. So in the first half, we'll be learning about the concepts behind network addressing. And for this part, it will be pre-recorded, because I just think that you will see more information with all the overlays. So in a short while, you'll be seeing me saying hi to you again. And we'll use 1 hour to cover all the concept of network addressing, and then we'll take a short break. In the second half, it will be live, and then we'll be trying out some examples together. So if you're ready, let's jump right into it. Hey guys, in this video, we are going to look into some of the rules used in computer network. Wait a minute, I meant the rules for computer network.
I have a pen. I have an Apple pen.
So let's say I have a PC here, and I'm connecting this PC with a LAN cable like this. Sounds satisfying. And I connect this to another device using the Ethernet connections like this. Sounds satisfying again. And with this, we build the simplest kind of network, which is called an ad hoc network. So this ad hoc network is also a kind of local area network. But normally you will have more than two devices in a local area network. So local area network is most commonly referred as to a LAN. So say it with me, it is called a LAN. So it is very important that you pronounce this correctly. But some people do call this a LAN, which is fine. Whether you want to call it a LAN or a LAN, as long as you don't call this a... Okay. When people ask you what do you learn in computer networks, I learn about so it doesn't really sound right. Yeah, so that's it. Local area network is also sometimes called as simply networks or subnets. So over here we have three local area networks: LAN 1 in pink color, LAN 2 in blue color, and LAN 3 in yellow color. Every computer network have their own network address. For example, LAN 1 is currently having the network address of 192.168.1.0/24. The next network rule says that two networks that are directly connected to the same router cannot share the same network address. In our example, since LAN 1 is having the network address 192.168.1.0/24, LAN 2 and LAN 3 cannot have this network address because they are all physically connected to the same router. In this case, LAN 2 can use any network address like 192.168.2.0 except 192.168.1.0. When any host joins a new network, they'll be given an IP address in the network either by static IP or by the DHCP server. In this example, PC1 is automatically assigned with an IP address of 192.168.1.1 by the DHCP server in LAN 1. In computer networks, end devices do not connect to each other directly. Most of the time, end devices are connected to a network switch that is then connected to a router to go on to the internet. When another new host joins LAN 1, it will be given another IP address similar to what happened to PC1. In this example, PC2 is given an IP address 192.168.1.2. Similar to how PC1 is connected to the switch, PC2 will also be connected to the switch before connecting to the internet. All the hosts in LAN 1 can freely talk to each other without needing to connect to the router. The communication can happen through the switch. In this case, we call this as a layer 2 forwarding, where switches will handle all the data being sent and received by the sender and the receiver. However, for any host in LAN 1 to talk to anyone else in LAN 2 and LAN 3, it needs to connect to the router. All of these networks are connected together by connecting the switches to the router. The general rule of computer network says that an IP address in the network has to be unique. This means that the IP address assigned to one host should not be reassigned to another host. In our example, PC1 is having the IP address 192.168.1.1. When PC2 joins the network, PC2 can get any IP address within the range of network 1, except the IP address 1.1 that is currently being used by PC1. In this case, luckily for us, PC2 get a unique IP 192.168.1.2, which is different from PC1's IP address. Well, if in some cases where you have mistakenly assigned a static IP, the same static IP to two different machines, then an IP conflict will occur. Now, what if we have an IP conflict? If PC1 and PC2 happen to have the same IP address, when the same packet goes to the router and forwarded to the switch, in this case, this becomes confusing for the network device. The network device will have a hard time figuring out who should this packet be sent to. Should it be PC1 or should it be PC2, who are both having the same IP address 1.2. Luckily for us, most modern operating systems has safety mechanism built in, and they should be able to detect when an IP conflict occur. Now, you're probably wondering, how can I find out what's the network address that I can use to be assigned to these networks? Is there a way for me to count them? Another question you might have will be, what IP address that I can assign to the host? To answer that, now we'll look into the concept of subnet mask. Okay guys, so you have seen the first part of network addressing. So what we have learned earlier is the basic rules of networking, and in computer network, we have a set of rules. Depending on where you're reading from, they define the rules in different order, but either way, the concepts are all the same. So far, we have learned about four network address rules, and these four of these rules are very important because later on, when we are going to learn how to calculate for network addressing, and also in some of the labs, you'll be building your own networks. All of the things that we build have to observe the rules that we have just seen earlier. So again, if you have any questions about the first four rules, I will answer to your questions right now before we go on to the next sections. Okay, so just a quick recap. Like right now, you're streaming from your home, I'm streaming from Utah, and all of us are in different networks. And each of our network will again have our own network address. So your network address and my network address, they are different. Okay, and the machine in Utah, my machine right now in Utah network, will have a different IP address from the machines that you are currently using right now in your home network. So this network address is very important in such a way that if you want to send a packet to a destination which is not in the same network, so that means it is in a remote network, then you have to know the destination address of the person that you are trying to send the message to. Okay, so that's network address. That's the first thing. Now, the second thing is for all the hosts in a LAN, you need to have your own IPv4 address. Of course, you can also use IPv6 if your network support it. But right now, most of us are still running on IPv4, and that's the first requirement, which also means that the very first thing a machine do when you take a new PC and then you connect the PC to a new network, the PC will ask for an IP address because it knows that without IP, you cannot talk to anyone, just that you don't have a name. So if you don't have a name, how should I going to address you? Okay, so that is the first thing. So these four rules, you have to remember these. Of course, you don't have to memorize the rules because eventually as you learn and as you go forward, as you build more network, all these things will come naturally to you. But as of now, since you are still new, you have to remember that the very first four rules says that every network have their own network address and all the hosts in the network have a unique IPv4 address. Okay? So I'll answer to your questions. If you have any questions, just drop it out on the chat and then I will project your questions on the screen so that everyone that is listening right now can know what you're asking. Okay, so for those who are thinking, what will we do with the Bob the Builder game? So that one we'll use that in the second half of this stream. Before we want to start building our own networks, we have to make sure we know the concept right first. Of course, you can start building straight away, but if you are not clear about the fundamental, then you'll just be guessing. So if you get some other network address in some other cases, then it might be quite confusing. So right now, we'll just continue forward, and then the next thing we want to learn about is about IPv4 address, and then we'll talk about subnet address. So if you're ready, we'll get into the next video. So here you are looking at the mini map of our lecture theater in LDK3. As you can see in the map, you have two Xuepa sitting in the front row. Now we'll forget about those who are sitting in the back and the middle row. So let's say, during the class, Xuepa somehow feels like she is Dora the Explorer, and she has been talking to herself for 2 hours. So now she decided to randomly pick one of the students to answer her question. So when she's looking, she found that Alex is staring at her. So she decided to pick Alex. And this explains why most of the students are always looking down at their feet when they know the lecturer is going to pick someone to answer the question.
Hey Alex!
You are the chosen one. So when Alex are called, Alex will respond to the question. And the reason Alex responded is because he is being addressed. So you see, in this case, the lecturer addressed Alex using his name. So here you get it. People address each other by their names. Now in a computer network, the same kind of addressing mechanism is being used to address a node or a destination machine. And instead of using names, machines use the IP address as the addressing mechanism to identify the host that they are talking to. In this example, we'll be looking at how the IP address and the MAC address and the port number works together to allow data communications to happen. So here we have two PCs, PC1 and PC2, which are in the same local area network. The IP address and the MAC address of both PC1 and PC2 is as shown in the network topology. The IP address is used to uniquely identify hosts on the internet. With the IP address, we can now send a packet to any destination host that are located in some other remote networks. Meanwhile, the MAC address is a unique hardware identifier of the machine. With the MAC address, the local machines can be uniquely identified within the local area network. Lastly, the port number is a unique number for all the applications that are running in a machine. Each application or network services they are running will be assigned an arbitrary port number or a well-known port number depending on the configurations. This number is important so that the machines that receive any network packets knows that this packet belongs to a particular service. Now, let's take a closer look at an example. Say now, a packet is being received on the router. From the packet information, we can tell that this packet is being sent to the host with an IP address of 192.168.1.1, which in our case is the PC1. This IP address is important so that the packet that is being sent from the internet knows how to get to this network where PC1 is currently located in. When the packet arrives in the local area network, this packet will be forwarded by the router to the switch. When the switch receives these packets, the switch will check its MAC address table to find which destination it should forward this packet to. The switch checks this MAC address to find out which is the rightful host. In our example, the switch knows that it should send this packet to a machine having the hardware address of ABCD AA112233, which is in our case again the PC1. When this packet finally arrives in PC1, PC1 will then check what application should it forward these packets to. This is common because on the machines, normally there are many services that are running at the same time. For example, you might have Google Chrome running in the background and playing some other games on another screen. In this case, PC1 will check the port number of the packets to decide where it should forward this packet to. In our example, the PC1 realized that this packet is destined for the applications that is running on port 1989, and based on the port number information in PC1, it knows that this packet should be forwarded to the game Wangzhe that is running on the port client port 1989. So there you have it. This is how IP address, MAC address, and port number works together to allow data communications to happen. So again, IP address is used to uniquely identify the network which a host is currently located in. Meanwhile, the MAC address is used to uniquely identify a host within a local area network. Lastly, the port number is used to uniquely identify the target applications that a particular packet is destined to. Some names are shared by many people, like Alex is actually quite a common name. Now, if there is two Alex in the class, then both of the Alex would have answered to the lecturers if the lecturer is asking Alex to answer the question. That's fine because you might have two or more Alex, but you wouldn't have the whole class as Alex. Now, if the lecturer decided to call, "Hey, handsome, yes, you, handsome, answer my question," then everybody in the class will answer the question because everybody thinks that they are handsome. But unlike people, the machines in the computer network cannot share the same identifier, or in other words, they cannot have the same IP address.
Okay, guys, so what you have seen is also another important concept, and by now you should know that in a computer network, actually, just like we can have many names depending on maybe your boyfriend will call you dear or baby, and then your mom will call you something else, right? So one, each of us have different ways being addressed, lah. So we have different names, and so is machines. So for machines, we have three addresses. Of course, there are more, but in this subject, we'll only talk about three. And that is the IP address, the MAC address, and the port number. And once you understand what are these addresses for, how are they different from each other, then you will get it very clearly what actually happened behind the scene when you are doing something on the internet. So for example, says that now you're streaming on YouTube right now, and I'm streaming to YouTube server. So the reason you can watch this video is because right now what I'm streaming will be sent as a data packet. So all the videos will be sent as data packet, and using a protocol we call RTP, which is used for streaming, and all my data will be transferred to the YouTube server. So when you're trying to watch this video, YouTube server is actually sending you all the data that I have uploaded onto the YouTube server, which is why and if you really look into what is going on, you will see that one day you will learn, okay, not now, but one day you'll learn how to use a tool to check what is going on the PC, and you actually see that the reason the packet that you are requesting from a YouTube server can be delivered to your machines but not someone else is because it is looking at the destination IP address, which is your machine that you are currently using. Okay, now in your home network, I'm sure that you don't only have one PC. There are many other people who are also using the same Wi-Fi, and maybe even yourself, you have more than one devices. So when the packet arrives at your home network, how does it know that this packet is supposed to be sent to your iPhone but not your iPad? Okay, so this happened by looking at the MAC address, and most of the time this is performed, we call this a layer 2 forwarding, and this is performed by a network switch. So what actually happened is that the switch will be looking at the destination MAC address, and then after that he will see, okay, now who is having this destination MAC, and I will send this packet to that particular node. Okay, so if you're using UniFi, you might be wondering, no, I don't see any switch in my network. So just something extra that you should know, the router that TM give to you when you install UniFi, it is actually a combination, it's a very pro device. They combine a router, a modem, and a switch into one device. So that router that you have when you subscribe to UniFi is actually a modem switch router, which is why you can have many devices that are connected to the Wi-Fi at the same time, because the router will also be acting as a switch that will be responsible to forward packets to all the hosts that are connected to your home network. Okay, so that three address is really important. You should remember that. So now I'll look at any questions that you have, and I'll answer your questions right now. Okay, so thank you for your questions. Now we have a really good questions here. What does layers mean? So your friend here is asking, just now during the videos you see there is layer 3, there is layer 2. So there are many other layers, and all these layers come from what we call the OSI model. So in OSI model there are 7 layers, and you can think of OSI model as a set of rules that tell all the machines how to communicate. Now, you will learn more about OSI in lecture 6. So as of now, you can just think of the OSI as a set of rules. So for example, let's say today I'm streaming on this stream, I'm speaking in English, right? Because most of you can understand English. Now, if I'm speaking in Chinese, maybe only half of you know what I'm talking about if you can speak Chinese. So, which is why I choose to use English, so that more people can understand what I'm talking about right now. And that is the OSI for all the machines. Because you see, for machines, you can have many, many different manufacturers. You can have Apple, who is making laptops. Dell is making laptops. Xiaomi is also making laptops, right, these days. So we need some kind of a mechanism that to make sure, although you are being built by different manufacturers, all of you speak a common language so that when everyone goes to the internet, we can understand each other. So that is done by what we call the OSI layer, and you will learn more about that in lecture 6, okay? Okay, now we have another very good questions here. I'll put it up for you in a short while. So thanks for your questions, Zhenren. Now, your friend is asking, why do we need both IP address and why do we need MAC address? Because what you have learned is that using MAC address, we can already forward packets to all the hosts in the LAN. So why would we need an IP address? Okay, now, actually they both work together. You are right if you think that we only need MAC address in a local area network, because your switch will be the guy who is forwarding all the packets between the sender and the receiver. Now, we still need an IP address because you have to remember that we don't always talk to a person who are always in the same network. Sometimes we are talking to a host who are in another network. For example, from Sungai Long, you want to talk to somebody in Gampa campus. And with that, you need the IP address. Okay, so you can think of it as this way. The IP address is a number that you use so that it's like your passport. So that when you go to other country, you need your passport. That is the IP address. Now, if you are traveling in Malaysia, you do not need a passport. You can just bring your IC. So that is kind of like your MAC address. Okay? Now, we have another good question coming up. And Ajo is asking whether we can change our MAC address. Okay, now, this is... I think you are smart if you ask this. Now, MAC address is a number for your hardware. So how do you get a MAC address? Normally, if you have one network interface card, you will have one MAC address. So if you don't remember, network interface card is the hardware or the card that allows you to connect to the internet. For example, if you're using an Ethernet connection, that Ethernet card is a network interface card, or we call this an NIC, a NIC. So if you're using a Wi-Fi connection, then your wireless adapter is the NIC. And all of these network interface card, the NIC, have one MAC address. So now today, if I go out and then I buy 10 more network adapters, I install all of them to my PC, then my PC will have 10 IP address if I join 10 network. And all those, for every network adapter, there is one MAC address. Now, whether you can change this number or not, the simple answer is no. This number is always the same for the hardware that you buy. So for example, let's say if I have, I actually have one here, so give me a minute. So now let's say what I'm holding here is a network card, and with this I can connect to the Wi-Fi network. So if you're using a desktop and you want to cut all the cables, you can buy something like that. And with that, you have a MAC address built in. So if you look at the back of it, you can also see the MAC address is written here. I'm not sure whether the camera can pick this up, but just know that for every network card, you have a MAC address, and this MAC address is fixed. That means that you cannot change this number. It comes with the device, okay? Now, if you are interested to know more about MAC, you can Google this up, but just to let you know, from the MAC address number itself, you can actually guess who built your network card. So there is a table that you can check, and by looking at the number or that is printed, you can say that Dell built this card, or Apple is the one who built this card, or Intel is the one who built this card. Okay, now there are some other numbers which is the unique ID, and that unique ID will represent this particular card out of so many other cards that the manufacturer is building. Okay, so now, But if you think that you want to change this number, there is a trick for you to change this. And most of our people these days, we do that. The reason is because right now, if you care about your privacy, okay, actually there is something we call a MAC address random Mac. They call this a random Mac. So if you are using Windows 10 right now, this function is already built into your computer. So what it means is that, like I said earlier, all network cards have a fixed MAC address that cannot be changed, but this poses a privacy issue. That means that if I see this number on the network, then I can actually guess what you're doing on the network. So in some cases, some people don't want, okay, I'm introvert, I'm shy, so I don't want people to know what I'm doing, and you can use the MAC address randomizer functions. So what it will do is the Windows will change number temporarily from your existing fixed MAC address to a random number. And every time you start the program, it will give you another random number. So it is very hard for you to guess who is using that MAC address. Okay? So I'll check if there's any other questions. Okay, so for Ayong also asked a question, but why do we need an IP and MAC? So for that, I've already answered earlier. So the reason is simple, because IP is like your passport. You need that if you want to go on to other networks. Of course, and MAC address is like your IC that you only need if you're traveling locally. So some of you might still be confused, like, okay, now in my network, in the LAN, I have all the network address that looks alike. So why do we still need IP address in the LAN? That's just because how network packets are built. So in later lectures, you will see the content of a packet. So when we are sending a data onto the network, we want to check what we are actually sending. And by that, and when you do that, you actually understand why you have IP address even for a local area network. Okay, so I do not want to confuse you. So I don't want to tell you too much about this now. When the time is right, then I'll tell you more. Okay. Okay, we have one more question coming up from Jacker, so let me put this up for you. Okay, now so your friend here, Jacker, is asking why would it be easier if you trace. Yes, you are right. Part of the reason MAC address it cannot be changed is because we want to know who is doing what on the network. But it goes both ways. You see, you can say that it is easier if we make this to be static so it cannot change. But on the other hand, you might argue that then whatever I'm doing can be seen by others. So it is not fair for the user as well. So depending on which cam you are on, if you think that we shouldn't change this so that we can monitor who is doing what for network security, then don't change. Now, if you think that, no, I don't want anyone to know what I'm doing on the network, then remember, there's always the functions built in on your Windows that allow you to change your MAC address. And if you are not running on Windows 10, there are many software out there that can help you to do the same thing. If you're interested, probably you can look out for something we call a MAC address spoofing or MAC address randomizer. Okay? So I guess that's all the questions that we have for these sessions. So if you're ready, we'll move on to the next video and we'll be going deep and take a look at how does IPv4 address looks like.
This is an example of an IPv4 address. An IPv4 address is 32 bits long. There are 4 octets in each IPv4 address. Starting from the left, you have octet number 1, octet number 2, octet number 3, and octet number 4 going to the right. Each octet in the IPv4 address is 8 bits long, which gives us the total of 32 bits long IPv4 address. For your information, 8 bits is equal to 1 byte. In other words, an IP vault address is 4 bytes long. If you think about it, the total number of IP vault address that we can have on the internet is given by 2 to the power of 32, which translates to 4294967295 number of IP addresses. Wow, that's a lot of IP address. IP vault address is normally accompanied by what we call the subnet mask. Subnet mask can be any number from 1 to 32. In this example, you have a /8 subnet mask. Subnet mask is important to determine the boundary of a network. You should know that subnet mask can be written as a slash notation, which is what you're seeing here, or it can also be written as a decimal notation or a binary notation. We'll talk more about subnet mask in a short while. In this example, you are seeing an IP vault address written in the decimal notation. In some cases, IPv4 address can also be represented in the binary notation. We can easily translate a decimal IP address into the binary format using the IP calculator or any scientific calculator that supports decimal to binary conversions. In our case, pressing the calculator, we can translate 192 into 11000000, and similarly, we can also translate 168 into 10101000. Doing the same for decimal 1, we get 00000001 as the binary notation. So there you have it. What you're seeing now in green color is exactly the same IP address that is represented in the binary notation instead of the decimal notation.
Okay guys, so what you have seen earlier is in-depth to of how what is an IPv4 address. So we have been using IPv4 address for quite a while now since we started playing the Alex Hacker game. And if you remember, we helped Alex to change his IP address from 1.88 to some other IP. So now what we want to learn in this lecture is specifically we want to know what kind of IP address that we can use to assign to a host in a local area network. Okay, and for us to do that, we have to really get to know the IPv4 address structures, which is what you have seen earlier. And then we also have to be familiar in how do we do decimal to binary conversions. So before I go further, I just want to give you a few examples of how you can do these conversions. So if you think, oh no, max, again max. Now, don't worry about that, because in this subject, there isn't really any max except for binary and decimal conversions, and maybe some AND operations, which is really, really simple. If you haven't already known this, I'm sure you'll pick it up really very easily. And yes, there is no formula, no max in this subject. Yeah, good news. So now I would like to share how can you do these conversions in a short while I'm giving you the example. But depending on what you like, there are many ways you can do the calculations. So if you are those kind of people who have a calculator and you have been carrying the calculator to all your final exam all this while, then stick with it. You can use your calculator to do decimal to binary number conversions. Now, if you don't want to do that, because now remember your test will be online, you can actually use the calculator on your Windows PC. That is a really good scientific calculator or the programmer calculator. Then you can use that. Now, Of course, you can also use any calculator that you find online. So in the short while, I will show you an example of decimal to binary conversion using a calculator that I found online. Okay, now, of course, there is one even better way, which is to use an IP calculator. So in a while, you will learn how to calculate all the addressing. And by the end of this class, I will tell you that everything that you have learned in this 1 hour can actually be done using a calculator that will only take 5 seconds. Okay, so I hope that you still stay with me after I said this, because in the exam, you have to show us how you calculate for all the network addresses. Okay, so before I go further, I will like to check on the questions first. So any questions, please drop it on the chat right now. Okay, hold on, we have a few questions coming up, so let me project these questions up for you. So again, thanks for your question, and your friend is asking whether you need VPN to change MAC address. No, actually you don't need to, because that is different thing, okay? A VPN allows you to join a network that you are currently being blocked. So for example, if you want to browse something that is hosted in China, or if you are from China, you want to use YouTube or Facebook, we know that they have this great firewall of China that's blocking everything. So one of the things that you can do is use VPN, or we call this a virtual private network. And the reason it works is because we are tricking all the networking devices that you are actually inside China, if you want to use something that's being blocked by China, or you're outside China. Okay, something like this. So that is VPN. For MAC address, it is different. MAC address is actually dealing with a layer 2 address, which means that you only need to install the software that help you to change the address number in your PC. Okay, so there is no need to use VPN for that. Okay, now we have another question here from Zhen Ren. So okay, if anybody want to put an X, you can always tell me and I can help you to project this out as well. So there's another simple question here from Chen Ren. So he's asking what is actually a host. Now, you might come across different words that I've been using throughout the lectures, but actually host refers to a machine. So in some cases, we can call a PC that is connected to a network as a host, or some of the time we call them a node. Okay, a node as in you are connected to a network, or people call this a PC or the end devices. So they are just wordings that we are playing around with, but they all refers to the same thing. You are a host means that you are a physical node that is currently connected to a local area network. Okay. Now we have another good question coming up from Azure, so I'll project this out so that everybody know what he has on his mind. And he's asking why so he's saying that he changed the whole system, his system, from IPv4 to IPv6, which is, maybe I should only trust you 50%, because for those who haven't heard about IPv6, for the context, in computer network we have two kind of addresses, which is IPv4 that we are going to learn in this subject, and we also have another kind of address called the IPv6 address. Now the reason IPv6 happens is because we are running out of IPv4 address. So if you remember earlier in one of the video, you see that there is a maximum number of IPv4 address that we can have. So you can get that number by taking 2 to the power of 32, because we have 32 bits of the value in an IPv4 address. So earlier, remember I said that, wow, that's a lot of address. So that's partly true maybe 10 years ago, yeah. But today, like you and me, we have so many devices. So one person might carry 3 phones, 4 phones, 5 phones. If I have 5 girlfriends, I have 5 different phones. And that 5 phones need 5 different unique IP address. So in a way, we are actually running out of IPv4 address, which is why we are starting to move to IPv6. Now, coming back to your friend's questions here, actually, we do not change the whole system from V4 to V6. Most of your machines that is already running on IPv6, good for you because it is actually faster, but you are actually running in a mode called dual stack, meaning that your PC is still an IPv4 PC while you are using IPv6, or the other way around. So you do not have a PC that is purely IPv4 only right now, or purely IPv6. That's because in some network, in some places, we are already moving to IPv6, which is a good sign, but there are still certain networks that are still on IPv4. So if you say you change the whole system to IPv6 only, then your machine will not be able to talk to any other PC that is still running on IPv4. And for context, the reason we are using V6 is because some servers, like most of the services that you are using, like Facebook, if I remember correctly, Facebook is one of them. They have already moved to IPv6, which is why if you browse Facebook on your phone today, you are actually using the IPv6 address on your phone instead of the IPv4 address. Now, if you go to Babel, of course, you are still using your IPv4 address. And that explains you actually need both address in a machine right now, but not changing entirely from V4 to V6. Okay? Okay, so if you are fine with all these things, we're going to take a 10-minute break. Yeah, 10-minute break is a long break. And when we come back, I will explain to you more about subnet mask, and then we'll learn how to calculate the network addressing, including what is the network address, the first address, the last address, and the broadcast address on the computer network. So I see you right back in 10 minutes.
Just be a queen. Don't be a drag, just be a queen. Give yourself prudence and love your friends. Subway can rejoice your truth. In the religion of the insecure, I must be myself, respect my youth. A different law is not a sin. Believe capital H, I am. I'm beautiful.
be a queen, whether you're broke or evergreen. Your black, white, beige, chola descent, your Lebanese, your Orient. Whether life's disabilities left you outcast or leader teased, rejoice and love yourself today, cause baby, you were born this
no
way.
No matter gay, straight or bi, lesbian, transgender life, I'm on the right track, baby, I was born to survive. No matter black, white, or beige, chola or Orient made, I'm on the right track, baby, I was born to be brave.
Just wanna be okay, be okay, be okay. I just wanna be okay today. I just wanna be okay, be okay, be okay. I just wanna be okay today. I just wanna feel today, feel today, feel today. I just wanna feel something today. I just wanna feel today, feel today, feel today. I just wanna feel something.
If you wanna go and take a ride with me, better hit me.
Okay guys, welcome back. So I hope you are ready, and then now we are going to look into your lecture slides. I need you to bring out your lecture slides because it might be helpful if you have something that you can refer to. And then I will explain to you slowly what is a network mask. And then from there, you will see how you can calculate the address range after you understand about network mask. So, okay guys, I hope you are ready. You can continue your chat after the class. I'll leave the stream open for a while. So now let's go to your slide, and you can skip all the previous slide if you have understand the video that I've shown earlier. And you can start with this slide. So it is slide number 16. If you are wondering, it is slide number 16. Go to number 16, and this is where you will learn about the subnet mask. Okay, so the concept of subnet mask, I want you to think of it as, yeah, let me draw this thing for you first. So what you're seeing here, you have a big circle here, and you can think of this like a cake. So let's say if you have a cake, right? You can cut the cake, and then you will divide the cake to several pieces, and then you can share this to your friend. Okay, now your question will be, how would I cut it? So there are many ways you can cut the cake, like you can just cut it half. So maybe I love you equally much, so I cut the cake half. So you take half, I take half. Or maybe you say that today I'm on diet, so I cannot eat too much of the cake. I can only take one slice. So I will cut in this way, one slice, and then I can take this part here. Wow, it is still considered as one slice. So you see, there are many ways you can cut a cake. So I want you to think of this cake as all the available IP address on computer network. So think of it as all. So actually, when I say all, it means you have the IP address start from 0.0.00 all the way up to the last address 255.255.255.255. So what you're seeing here, this address range is all the available IP. Right now, your PC is using one of the IP address inside this range, okay? So this is the biggest cake. And how do we cut this cake so that different network will get different IP addresses? So try to think about this. You have company who is like big company, Apple, Google, and you have some smaller SMB company. So on a big company, you need so many IP addresses because you have more employees. If you compare that to a smaller company, like you only have like 10 people, right? So if you have a small company, you do not need that many IP address. So you have a smaller network. And then if you have on a big company, you have a bigger network. So what I'm trying to tell you is that, let's say this cake here is all the available IP. There are different ways we can cut them. So for example, I should cut this in a way that now this big slice here can give to Google, because Google has so many employees. Then maybe the next slice here, this is slightly smaller because I want to give this to Utah. Okay, Utah is not big, not small. We have quite a number of staff, but it's not as big as Google. So again, if you have an even bigger company, like maybe you say Apple, so you want another bigger slice for Apple. So you see, you can try to imagine this, like all the addresses that are available, we need to find a way to cut them in an effective way so that many people can get IP addresses now. So, when we are doing this, we call this a kind of a classful addressing. Okay, so in a short while, you'll see what does classful addressing means. But the question now is, how do we cut this cake? Okay, now how do I decide how big or how small, or which what company get bigger size, what gets smaller size? Now this is done by the by an organization. It is not a company. And they are called IANA. If you would like to know more about them, you can Google up IANA. This is a body that is controlling all the IPv4 addresses in the world. Which means that now, for example, today Maxis or TM, they are your ISP, the internet service provider. And when you subscribe to Unify the ISP should, they need to give you an IP before address so that you can get to the internet. So who give, who is the one who give the IP address pool to DM so that when you subscribe to Unify, DM can give you one IP address? That person is IANA, A-I-I-A-N-A. So this is a body that control who get what IP before address. Okay, but normally they don't deal with us directly. They will deal with ISP, and then from the ISP, which who are like people like Cellcom, Maxis, and UniTM, those ISP will then again give the IP address to us. Okay, now that is who is giving us the IP. But how do we cut this slice, this big cake into different slices? And that one, of course, like I said earlier, it is decided by IANA, but technically, the way you cut it is you need to use this thing we call a subnet mask. So what you are seeing here, a slash 24, represent a subnet mask. Now, if you go back to one slide earlier, the slide that I'm showing you is slide 16. If you go back one slide earlier to slide 15, over here, I'll explain what is a subnet mask. So a subnet mask is just any number that you see here that range from 1 to 32. So this can be number 1 to number 32. But most of the time, we start with slash 8. So this is how we write a subnet mask. So if I say my network have a subnet mask of 12, so the way I write will be I write slash 12. This is how I represent a subnet mask. Okay, now, actually there are three ways to represent a subnet mask. I will show you in a short while. Not to confuse you, I will just use the slash notation for now. So again, this is the range, all the numbers that you can use in the place of subnet mask. But remember, most of the time, we start with slash 8 to slash 32. So if you are asking which is correct, both are correct. Slash 1, technically, it is correct, but normally people don't start subnet mask from 1. We start it from a slash 8, okay? Now, what does this subnet mask mean to us? With a subnet mask, we can now tell how big is the network, which also means what is the network boundaries. And when we know the size of the network, we can know what is the first address, what is the last address that I can use to be assigned to a host in the network. So for us to understand that, you should know that an IP before address can be divided into two portions, okay? We call this the network portions and the host portion. So if you go back to slide number 16, you will see that now the IP address that you are seeing here is divided into network bits on the left and host bits on the right. Now, how do I separate that? Before I talk about separating, okay, now, you should know that the reason we have this is because the front part. So I want you to look at the front part of the address that is represented, that is representing the network bits. So all these number here that you are seeing are used to build networks, okay? Whereas the last part here, the one in green color, is used to assign to hosts in the LAN. So for example here, on the internet, I have Apple, I have Google, I have so many companies that need to have their own network. Remember, every network has their own different network address. So the part here that you see in the front, these are the number that we can use to create different network for different company. Now, for each network that we have created, inside the network, of course, we have many different hosts. We have PC, phone, all these things. And remember, all these things need to have an IP address. And this part here, the host bit, is the part where we can use to give this IP address to the host in the LAN. So you have to get this concept right first. In the IP before address, there are two parts, the network parts and the host part. We call this network bits or the host bits. The network bits is used to create networks, whereas the host bits is used to assign, to be assigned to a host in a local area network. Okay? Now, the next thing you should know is that this network bit and host bit, of course, you can only play around within 32 bits because remember that an IP before address is 32 bits long. So you can have bigger network bits, smaller host bit, or you can have more host bit, but smaller network bits, right? So how do we decide on this? This is done by using the subnet mask. So the subnet mask that we learned earlier is actually this line here. If you can see this line here, this is the subnet mask, and we use this to decide how many network bits that I want to have and how many host speed that I want to have. Now, for example here, the example that you're seeing right now is a /24 address. This means that this network is having a /24 as the subnet mask. Now, when we want to draw the line of the subnet mask, we'll draw it here. I will show you in a short while how I decide where to draw the line. But as of now, I want you to understand the concept of having more network bits or having less network bits. So if I draw a line here, it means that the front part here, I have 3 octets. Remember, 4 octets in IPv4 address. The first 3 octets will be used to build networks, which also means that the total number of networks I can build is 2 to the power of 24. So how do I get the number 24? Every octet is 8 bits. So if I have 3 octets here, then this is 24 bits. So when I do this, it means that I can build so many networks because I have so many numbers that I reserve to be used to build networks. But I cannot have too many hosts because you see, the remaining part here, I have only 8 bits left in the place of the host bits. So if I ask you, how many IP address that you can give to all the PC in the network that you have just built? You will find by using 2 to the power of 8. And the reason we get 8 is because now you have 8 bits here, which is not that many. Okay, so try to think about this again. The front part here, we have a lot of IP that is allocated to build many networks. But in each of the networks, you can only have 2 to the power of 8 number of IP address that you can assign to a host. Okay. Now, if this is confusing, try to take this slowly and try to think about this again. And I will give you another example here using the slide before this. So if you go back to slide 15, you have a /28 mask. So if I want to draw the subnet mask line here, I will draw it here. Again, don't worry where to draw. The example is coming up real soon. But for now, just think that I will draw it. Okay, now this is not a good example. So let me change this to a /16. Okay, so if I change this to a /16, that means I will draw the subnet mask line in right in the middle of the IPv4 address. And that means the front part here, I will have 16 bits available as the network bits, and I also have 16 bits left as the host bits. Now, if you are thinking, how do I get 16 bits again? I have 2 octets here. 1 octet is 8 bits, 2 octet is 16 bits. Okay, now the last part here, also again, I have 2 octets, which is why I have 16 bits. So how is this address different from the one, the /24 that we have seen earlier? It is different in terms of how many network you can build. So in this example, the maximum number of network we can build is actually given by 2 to the power of 16 because we have 16 bits here. But although we can build less number of networks, the good news is in each of the network that we build, we can have more IP address in those network to be assigned to the host, which is also again 2 to the power of 16 IP addresses that we can use to be assigned to the host, which is quite a big number. Okay, so that explains what is subnet mask for. With subnet mask, we can draw the boundary between the network bits and the host bits in an IPv4 address, and then we can know what is the size of the network. Okay, now after that, I want to show you how do you know where to draw the line. So for example here, if you have an IP address 192.168.1.1/, okay, now before that, to make it visible for you, I will draw 3 lines here to represent the octets. So if you remember in one of the slides, we say that every IPv4 we have 4 octets, So this one here is the first octet on the left, and then you have octet number 2, octet number 3, and the last one is octet number 4. Okay, and again remember, each of the octets is 8 bits in size. Okay, 8 bits. So if I have a mask and I say that this is a slash 8 mask, what it means is that I have 8 bits of 1. Okay, if I have a slash 16 mask, it means I have 16 bits of 1. If I have a slash 24 mask, it means I have 24 bits of 1. Now, if you want to see this clearly, you have to do the decimal conversion first, decimal to binary conversions. So, let me show this to you. In every octet, remember again, you have 8 bits. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this is octet number 1. You have the same thing in octet number 2. So you have 6 bits here. Here again, you have 8 bits here. So again, you have 8 for each of the octet. And in total, you'll get 32 bits of numbers, okay? Now, over here, I will use an example of slash 8 first. So if we say that you have a slash 8 mask, it means that the first 8 bits is all 1. So it will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. 8 ones here, and the rest are all 0. So you have all zeros for the remaining octet 2 and octet 3. So that is what we mean by a slash 8 mask. Now, if this is a slash 16 mask, then it means that you have 16 1 in the first 16 bit. So you have 1 1 1 1, 1 1 1 1, and then again you have another 8 1 here, and the rest will be followed by all zeros. So the last two octet, you have all zeros. Okay, so that gives us the slash 16 mask, and the next example is a slash 24 mask. So a slash 24 means that you have 24 1. Starting from the left, you have 8 1 here, again another 8 1, and in the third octet you have again all 1, and with this you have a slash 24. So this is what you get with slash 24, and the rest will be all 0. Okay, so take a few seconds and try to think about what we have here. This is the binary representations of subnet mask, and it is very important for you to know how do we derive this number. Okay, and okay, the next thing I want to tell you is, if you look at this thing here, it means that a slash 8 mask, you will have all the first octet set to 1, slash 16, all the first and second octet set to 1, a slash 24, all the first, second, and third octet is set to 1. Okay, now if you are clear about this, we'll come back to this example later, where we will see some other odd numbers. So for now, we'll stick with slash 8, 16, and 24. So based on what you've seen here, you can actually say that the first octet until here, you have slash 8. The second octet is slash 16. And the third octet here is slash 24. Now this is something that you should remember, so that in the future when you're trying to calculate for network addressing, this will speed up what we are trying to calculate. Okay, so again, on this side here, you have a slash 8. Here you have slash 16. The third one is slash 24. Now, based on this example, the next thing you want to know is, what are their differences? Okay, so from here you can tell, a slash 8 will actually give you only 8 bits of network bits, but you have 24 bits of host bits. A slash 16, you have 16 bits of network bits, the left part, you have 16 bits of host bit for the right part. Now a slash 24, you have so many network bits, 24 bits on the left for all the network bits, you only have 8 bits remaining for the host bit on the right. So what does it mean for us? Let's say if I have an IP address 192.168.1.0. So this is a network address. And you see, if I have a slash 8 mask here, it means that only the first part here is reserved for the network bit. So you can tell that over here, this is for the network bit, and the remaining 24 bits is for the host bit. So from here, you can tell that a slash 8 mask is good if you want to build just a small number of network, but in each of the network you have many PC that need IP address. Okay, now based on the same logic, if I have the same network address with a different subnet mask, so a slash 24 mask for example, so you know that a slash 24, so just to write this down for you, a slash 24 means that you have 24 bits for the network bits, which means that if I will highlight this in orange color, 8, 16, 24. So all these will be used for the network bits and only 8 bits left for the host, which means that you have 24 net bits but only have 8 host bits. So what does it mean for you is that this addressing is good if you want to build many networks, okay, for many company, but all the company is only using small number of IP addresses. So you think that maybe 8 bits is enough for you to assign IP address to all the endpoints. So that is how we use subnet mask to determine the boundaries of a network. Okay. Now, if you can kind of get what I'm trying to explain here, you can go back to your slides number 17, and this slide here is explain what I'm just trying to show you earlier. So, as you can read here, when the number of network bits increase, we can create more networks. If you want to learn more using the animations, please check out the video that I posted online. That video is animated and you can get the idea better. But if you just want to go to the slides, so what it means here is that if you have more network bits, you build more networks. If you have but your network is very small, okay? If you have only a few network bits, you cannot build too many networks, but you can have a very big network because so many bits are left for the host bits. Okay? Now, continuing from that, if you go to slides, the next slide, number 18, you will see what we call a classful addressing. So this is continuing from the example that I've shown you earlier where we try to see how many bits we have in the host bit and the network bit. Now, a classful addressing is an old addressing scheme. We don't use the classful addressing anymore, but if you want to know more, you can. It is just that in early days, when IPv4 is first introduced, it is running based on class A, class B, and class C. And the reason is simple. Like what we have said earlier, class A, you cannot build too many networks because you only have 8 network bits, but each network will be very big. Okay? So, in early days, people divide the addresses to class A, B, C, and their difference is that in class A, you only have the first 8 bits as the network bit. Okay, while the remaining one, you can use it to assign IP address to all your hosts in the network. Now, class B, you have 16 network bits, and then the remaining 16 will be used to assign IP to the host. And then class C, which is the most common one, you have so many networks, but the network will be very small. So what you have seen earlier, the example that I gave you earlier, is actually an example of classful IP addressing. So actually it is the same thing. So what the takeaway for this slide here is that you should know their difference is if you have class A, you cannot have too many networks, but the network will be very big. And then if class C, you can build many more networks, but the network will be way smaller. Okay, that's the first takeaway. The second takeaway is that if you see a /8 mask, it means that it is a class A address. If it is a /16, it is a class B. And if you see a /24, it is a class C address. If you are using classful addressing in IPv4. Okay, so now I'll give you a few minutes to think about this, and then I'll check out all your questions. And if you're okay, then we'll go forward on how we can calculate the network address range. Okay, now, guys, I know this is getting a little bit hardcore. So if you're confused in any of the part, please just replay the video. You should be able to get it. Okay, now we have a question here. So for /8, do we draw the line after the first octet? So let me project this out for you. Okay, now PN, yes, this is a good question. You are right. So it's very simple. /8, you cut it in the first octet. /16, you cut it in the second octet. /24, you cut it in the third octet. So in fact, I'll give you one example to make this clearer to you. So if I have an IP address like this, so say I have 10.10.10.0. Now if So now if you get a /8, then you cut it here. Which means that the first octet will be the network and the remaining three will be the host. Okay, now if you have a /24 with the same subnet address, so 10.10.10.0/24, you will cut it in the last octet. Which means that you have the first three octet as the network bit and the last octet as the host bits. Okay? Now, what about /32? That's a very cute question, but you cannot have /32 because that will be the end of the IP address, meaning that you do not leave any bits for the host. You cannot have network that you don't have enough bits to assign IP address to the host in the network. So actually 32 doesn't work. Even for /31, we don't use it. So normally we will start from /8 to /30. Okay, now, so the next question here, ISP use 24 bits. Okay, now this is again a very good question. Do you think that UniFi is using a /24 bits for all our home network? Actually, no. Okay, what we are learning here is theoretical, meaning that, of course, if you want to save address, you will use class C. That makes sense, right? Because you don't have too many PC in a home network. But right now, remember, this is classful addressing, which is actually an old addressing scheme. And in today's modern network, we do not use classful addressing anymore, which means that you can actually use a mask which is /29 or /30 or /27 instead of /24. Okay, in a short while, I will show you one example of this kind of weird, or we call this an odd number, and technically this is called a CIDR, classless inter-domain routing. Okay. Why do people... Now we have another interesting question here, which is actually the same question. When do people use a /32 mask? You use it if you want to prank somebody, okay? nobody use a slash 82 mask lah. What if it is a slash 9? Okay, now this is a very, very good question. Again, Jack has been asking us a lot of good questions. Now, if this is a slash 9, how do we draw the line? Okay, I'll give you one example on this. But it is not that straightforward because the example that we gave, that we used earlier, I write them in decimal notation. So if you want to cut a slash 9, you have to do a decimal to binary conversion first. So for example, if you have, slash 8. So remember that you have again 4 octets, so you have slash 8, slash 16, slash 24. Now, if you want to cut it at 9, so let's say you have IP address 192. /9. Now, how can I cut it? First thing is, you have to remember for each octet you have 8 bits, right? So I'll just write all 8 bits in terms of x first. Now, 9 means that I have 9, 1 in the subnet mask. 8 means you have 8, 1. That is simple. If it is 8, then you know that all this is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. This is a slash 8. Okay, this is slash 8. Now, for slash 9, you just add another 1 here. And then the rest will be 0. That is how you cut if you have a slash 9 address. Which means that here, you have 9 bits for network, and then the remaining will be for the host. So you have remaining 23 bits for the host. Okay, so this is a little bit different because you have 1 extra bit here. Okay. If you can see this clearly, this is how I cut at slash 9. So this means this is a slash 9 subnet mask. Okay. So since we are already in this example, I'll give you a few more hints about subnet mask first. Now, when we represent subnet mask in terms of binary, say I have 3 octets again. One of the rules you should remember is that all the 1s and 0, they have to start from all 1s and then all 0. So let me show you what I mean here. So let's say if you have a slash 32 mask, if you have 2-1, then you have it should be 2-1, and then it will be followed by all 0. Okay? Now if you have 3 ones, then it should be 3 1, and then it is followed by all 0. So, one of the rules in subnet mask is that you cannot have 0 before 1. So, you cannot have, this is correct, but you cannot have something like this. You cannot have a 0, and then you have 1, 1, and then you have 0, 0. Okay? So, that is not correct. Remember, for subnet mask, it's always start with 1, and then it depends on how many 1 do you have for the network bits. You cannot start with a leading 0. Okay, so this example here, this is not correct. Now, another rule is that you cannot have 1 and 0 that is alternating with each other. So, for example, regardless of how many 1 do you have, you can have 8 1s, and then you can have all 0. That is correct, but you cannot have something like if you have 1, 1, and then you have a 0 in between, and then you have another 1, and then you have 0, 1, 0. So that is not correct, okay? So the second rule is that for a subnet mask, you cannot have 1 and 0 that is alternating with each other. So this example here is not correct. Okay, now I'll give you a better example by doing the decimal to binary conversions. But before that, I will check out the other questions first. Okay, now you have another question from Yu Hong asking that we only have slash 8, 16, and 24 to differentiate between network and host. No, actually, like I said earlier, subnet mask can be any number from slash 1 until slash 32. The problem is that if you use slash 32, then you do not have any bits left for the host bit, so we don't use slash 32. If you use slash 1, you only have one bit for the network, which is also weird, which is why we don't use a slash 1. So most of the case, you can use any number of subnet mask from slash 8 to slash 30. Okay, now we have another good question coming up. So, your friend is asking, if ISP use a 24-bit subnet mask, does our IP address start with 192 and not 255? So why? Okay, I think you are a little bit confused here. Subnet mask is not IP address. Subnet mask is used to determine the range of the network or the IP address. So remember, IP address and subnet mask are two different things. In a short while, when you learn about how to calculate the address range, you will see this clearly. Okay. Now we have last questions coming up. Now, if the host exceeds the limit, the network will not let anyone enter by installation. So your friend is asking if you do not have enough IP address in the network. For example, you use a slash 24 address and then you have too many people that need IP address. So you run out of IP before. Actually, it will not result in slower speed, except those people without IP address will not be able to talk on the network. So it will happen in something like this. Let's say if I have 10 IP address available, but I have 12 hosts who want to join the network, the last two hosts will not be able to talk on the network until someone left the network. So that IP address will be free. That free IP address will then be reassigned to the hosts who are waiting for an IP address, which is the host number 11. Okay? Now we have another questions coming up from Yu Hong. So we have a same IP address with different subnet masks. Yes, Yu Hong, you are right. Which is actually a big problem in computer network. So if for those people who can get it, your friend is saying that you can have one IP address, but the subnet mask can be slash 32 and another same IP address with another different network mask slash 28. So in this case, if you really think about this, one of the address is actually within the range of the other address. Now, it might be too early for me to tell you that. So what you should know right now is that this, because of this, sometimes we have to be very careful when we design IP addressing so that we don't have cases where two networks actually overlap with each other. Because like what your friend say here, two IP address can have two different subnet masks, and in some cases they might be overlapping with each other. Anju, what questions do you ask? I thought I already finished scan through all the questions. Can you retype your questions if you have any more questions? That's fine, because maybe he is not having a smooth full HD stream. Okay, now since all the questions here is done, we'll move on to the next example, which is a little bit an advanced example of a subnet mask. So for this, we'll go back to your slide. So going back to the example that we had earlier, the very first place that we learned about subnet mask, so we know that a slash 8 means you have 8 bits for the network, 16 means you have 16 bits, 24 means you have 24 bits. Now, this, remember, this is called a classful addressing. And in some cases, you have to know that right now, people don't just stick with 8, 16, and 24. It can be any random number from slash 8 to slash 30. So what if we have a mask which is, say, slash 25? So let's say if I have a slash 25 mask, the logic is the same. It means that I have 25 1 for the network bits. So I will write 1111 1111 for first octet, for the second octet, and for the third octet as well. So until here, you know that you already have 24 1, and we need one more. 25. So it will be 1 here, and then the rest will be 70 here. So that is what we mean by a slash 25 mask. Now with this slash 25, it is called a CIDR. So what we have learned earlier, 8, 16, and 24 is called a classful address. Any other number that is not that 3 number is called a CIDR, which stands for classless inter-domain routing. Okay, which means that if you have slash 26, slash 27, that all belongs to CIDR. Okay, next, for those who are interested to know how can we write subnet mask, actually there are 3 ways we can represent a subnet mask. So what you see here on the very left on the slide, slash 8, 16, and slash 24, this is called a slash notation. Okay, so most of the time, if you are writing the answer for your exam or things like that, you'll be writing in the slash notation because this is the quickest way we can write a subnet mask. Okay, now what you see here on the right is the binary representation of the same subnet mask. And when do we need to write in binary notation? You only need to do so if you want to perform some AND operations when you are calculating for the network address range. Other time, we don't want to write in binary because it is taking you a lot of time. Okay? Now, there is a third notation that we call the decimal notation. If you want some context, you can go to your slides. There's a slide with a table that shows you there are actually 3 notations for to represent the subnet mask. So over here, if you look at slides number 19, now on slide number 19, you will see that there are 3 ways we can represent the mask. So let's say we use a classful addressing as example. A slash 8 means you are writing in slash notation, and then a binary notation, like what we have learned earlier, means that you have 8 1 here, followed by all zeros here. Okay, so we have learned about this. Now there's a third one we call a decimal notation, and this is the one that we will write when you want to configure any network devices. So this is very important. Now, if you write a slash 8 to a machine, the machine will not understand. If you write the binary notation again, the machine will not understand. So that means if you want to configure any network devices, including your PC, your routers, your switches, if by any chance you need to put in the subnet mask, you have to put it in the decimal notations. So how do we get the decimal notation? It's actually quite simple. If you go back to the example you have earlier, based on what you have here, all you really need to do is to convert this binary number back to its decimal notation. So I will show you how I do the conversions. And you can, again, like I said earlier, you can always use your calculator of your choice. But for me, I'll be using a calculator I find online. This is called a binary to decimal calculator. If you want to use this, you can look up for rapid tables. What you're seeing here, the rapid tables, and I find this really convenient, so I'll be using this. Now, so if you are want to use this, what you really need to do is you have to be clear about whether you are going from binary to decimal or decimal to binary. So in our case, I'm converting from a binary number to a decimal number, and I want to convert it once. So in this place, I'll put 1111, 1111, 8 once. If you press convert, you will get the decimal equivalent, which translates to 255. So in this case, this is how I find out that this also means 255. Okay, of course, if you translate 8 zeros, you will get zeros in decimal notation. So 0, 0, 0. Now, I will highlight this in yellow for clarity. The first class A address with a slash 8 mask, you'll get 255.0.0.0. Now, doing the same thing here, if I press my calculator, I will get 255 for... hold on a second. So what you're seeing here is that the 8 ones has now been converted to 255 and all the 8 zeros will be zeros. Okay, now for slash 16, we do the same. All ones become 255. Again, 8 ones become 255. 8 zero becomes 0. 8 zero becomes 0. So a slash 16 subnet mask, when you write them in decimal, it is 255.255.0.0. Now the same thing for slash 24. It will be 255.255.255.0. So that is the decimal representation for slash 24 mask. Okay? Now for slash 25, it is not that straightforward. You have to be careful when you press the calculator. For the first octet is 255. So all ones will translate to 255. You can just remember this. Another 255 here, 255 here, and then the last octet is 1000000. So for this, we will go back to the calculator. So bring up the calculator here, and let's find out what is 1000000 in decimal. So it will translate to 128, which means that the binary, the decimal representation for a slash 25 is 255.255.255.128. So to make this clearer, I'll just enclose this in a bracket for you. So what you're seeing here is the same thing, except that you're just writing them in different notations. And now if you go back to your slides here, you will find exactly the same thing. And yeah, I can just show you the slides here. And from here you can see this is why a slash 8 mask, you have 255.0.0.0, because you have 8 ones here. And this is why for class B slash 16, you have 255.255.0.0, because you have 16 ones here. This one, 255.255.255.0, because you have 24 ones here. So every 8 ones will be translated to 255.255.255. And then last one is 0. Okay, so I hope that you are clear about how you write your subnet mask in different notations. And that is all for these lectures. I hope, I think it's really important for you to go back and make sure you are clear about the subnet mask, what is subnet mask for, how can we write subnet mask in different ways. And then in the coming lectures, I will show you how we can use this subnet mask to calculate the network address range so that we know how big or how small is the network. Okay, so for the remaining of the time, I will stay on the stream to answer all other questions about subnet mask. If for those who are okay, then you can leave the stream earlier. Thank you for joining. Again, like always, any questions, put it on Slido. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Please ask questions if you have any questions right now. Okay, bye-bye.
Kiss my lips like a feather. New wind just like this. No, it's never been better than the summer of 2002. We were only 11, but acting like grown-ups, like we are in the present. Drinking from plastic cups, singing love is forever and ever. Well, I guess that was true. Dancing on the hood in the middle of the woods on an old Mustang, where we sang songs with all our childhood friends. And it went like this, say, oops, I forgot. Not enough, I'm not singing ba-ba-ba. Hold up, if you wanna go and take a ride with me, better hit me, baby, one more time. Paint a picture for you and me.
Change. Oh, I couldn't stop it, tried to figure it out. But everything kept moving, noise got too loud. With everyone around me saying, you should be so happy now. Oh, you keep preaching that I keep coming back. If you'll come back, then I'm okay with that. If you leave the light on,